The Sunday, the first day of the week, where we can celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ, his resurrection, and the fact that we saints will join him and our loved ones today. This is just a wonderful, special day to be together. And we're going to begin by singing Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Now, the hymn number is actually 575, not 757. So, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, 575.
Sunday school back starting on the first Sunday in June, which is June 6th. For the adults, we're going to be meeting in the sanctuary. We'll be having rotating teachers, and I hope that you will plan to join that in the sanctuary class starting at 9 o'clock. The children will be meeting downstairs and the youth. And then also, we have the a homecoming that Sunday. That is our homecoming. We did not get to celebrate last year, of course, because of the COVID. But we're going to be meeting together that morning during the sanctuary, and we're going to have homecoming. We'll be remembering those who died in the last couple of years. We had, like I said, we were not able to do that last June. And also, after the homecoming on June the 6th, during the following the worship service, we will have a dinner on the grounds. And so this is wonderful to get together and fellowship together. We just talked about leaning on the everlasting arms and the fellowship we have with the Lord, but the fellowship we have with one another. And I have missed it so very much. So I hope that you will participate in that. And then also our in our care ministry, this coming week we will be introducing Barbara Brady as our homebound church member. We want to remember her by cards and through calls, and I think it just means so much to her and to her family. Let her know that we love her and that we care for her. So if you would do that, her address is in the bulletin. At this time, if you would please join with me in prayer. Our gracious Lord, thank you for another gorgeous day. And Lord, we come in the fellowship of the blessing of you as you bless us with your presence, as we come in the name of the only begotten Son of God, Jesus Christ our Lord. And as your people, Father, we come and we confess our sins to you. And we pray, O Lord, that you help us to just trust in Jesus who shed his blood on the cross at Calvary, the one who was raised from the dead and has given us not only forgiveness of sins, but has given to us the wonderful, wonderful, blessed assurance of eternal life. And thank you, Lord, that we are your children and that one day as Jesus comes that we will be fully adopted as we've been predestined, as we have trusted in Jesus to be adopted as sons and daughters of God. We thank you for the many, many privileges that come through our faith in Christ. Lord, that you'll never leave us or forsake us. We know, Father, they're broken hearts. We ask that you'll mend those. We ask that you'd be with those who are grieving, that you'll give them comfort and strength. We pray, O Lord, that those who are sick and in pain, we pray, O God, for blessed relief. And knowing, Lord, that we wait upon you, we are human. We know, Lord, that there are many things that we experience that are unpleasant. And yet, Father, somehow, some way, you take those things and you help us to become stronger. And we thank you for it. Lord, have your way in this service today, that you bless the music, that you bless in the children's message, Father, that you be with your servant as I stand before your people to proclaim the word. May it all be for your honor and glory, for we pray it in Jesus' wonderful, precious name. Amen. Amen.
Once again, if you're able to stand, as we sing 581, 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus.
Just to take him at his word.
thank you. You may be seated, and Tammy, you'll come, children, you'll come forward at this time. And I'd also like to ask, while we've got a little break here, if you would just turn around and say hello to your neighbor and let them know you're glad that I'm here today.
Hello, neighbor.
You know, it's just a honor to know this, that you're welcome. Amen. There you go.
Tell me the story of Jesus.
Good morning, everybody. I'm so excited to be up here, and I'm so excited to kick off this year's countdown for Vacation Bible School, which is going to be June 27th through June the 30th, which is a Sunday through Wednesday from 6 to 8 p.m., and we just would love for everyone to come out if they can. So this year's theme is actually the thing that we were going to use last year. We had already bought all that curriculum and stuff before the shutdown. So if you see anything that says 2020 on it, you'll know why. But the thing that we're going to use is called Concretes and Cranes, which is kind of a building and construction theme. And we're going to learn how to build a strong relationship with Jesus. And so, I don't know if you know this or not because you're young, but when you build a house or build anything else, one of the most important things that you can do is to build a strong foundation, to put that house on a strong foundation. This is so important that Jesus even talked about this. In Matthew 7, he says, a wise man builds his house on the rock, so that when the rains come down and the streams come up and the winds blow against that house, it stands firm. It doesn't fall because it's built on the rock. But a foolish man builds his house on the sand, and when the rains come down, and the streams come up, and the winds blow against it, that house comes down with a loud clash, because it was built on the sand. He says that anyone who hears his word and goes out and practices his word is like the man who built his house on the rock. We're firm in our foundation. He said that anyone who hears his word and does not practice his word is like the foolish man. In the fall. I think in today's society and in the state that we're in, we need to help these kids build as firm of a foundation as we can.
Amen.
Because all of our foundations are being tested. Not only are we hearing anti-Christian rhetoric from media and superstars, we're hearing it from our nation's leaders. I don't know how many of y'all keep up with the news, but I do. And if you know about history, each year when Congress convenes, they start with a prayer. This 117th Congress that came together this year was no exception. They started out with a prayer. It was led by a representative from Missouri who professes to be a Methodist Christian. When he closed that prayer, he closed it with, a man, a woman. Now, that raised some eyebrows because most of us know that the word amen has nothing to do with gender at all. But more egregiously than that, he prayed that prayer to Brahma, who was a Hindu god. And then we wonder why our nation is in the state that it's in. On top of that, a newly elected senator who professes to be a Baptist preacher on Easter Sunday put out a tweet that said, the meaning of Easter is more transcendent than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It went on to say that whether you're a Christian or not, that through a commitment of helping others, we can save ourselves. Now, the Holy Bible says that by grace are you saved, and not of good works, lest no man should boast. We need to instill this in our kids.
Amen.
The first lesson in Bible school this year is going to teach that the love of Jesus cannot be earned. Jesus chooses to love us, and we need to tell this to our kids. I think that we would all agree that the universal symbol of love is the heart, yes? And that no greater love has been shown than when God sent Jesus, his son, to die on the cross to save us from our sins. So this year, for our promotional, we've got a little set of building blocks here, and it's hard to kind of see through this bag of building blocks. We've got a set of each set has a pattern in it that you can make a heart or you can make a cross. So as you take these and you play with them, and you can probably make other stuff with them, I would like each time you look at it to remember that Jesus loves us. We can't earn that love. And that I hope you remember to also say a prayer for Bible school. So you can take these and you can keep them and say a prayer every time you see it, or give them as some to someone else to invite them to Bible school. It also has all the Bible school information on there. Now, in order to have a good Bible school, we need to build a good Bible school. And as the preacher has been saying, we do need some workers. Last year, I think we had about 10 or 11 people who came in from outside of this church to help us with Bible school. And there's nothing wrong with that. My family enjoys helping, and I know that other people's families enjoy helping, and we're not saying that we don't want or welcome those people to come and help us. My sister loved doing it. She's already said that she would love to be a teacher, but she's also said that if people in this church want to do it, that she will gladly step aside. My nephew, I saw him a few weeks ago, and the first thing he asked me, he said, "Tiffany, are we doing Bible school this year?" And I said, "Yes, we are." And my niece also enjoys helping. So what I've done, because you may not know what all we need for Bible school, is I have this list here of all the positions that need to be filled in Bible school. Now, I've already put in names of people who have said that they are willing to help and want to help. If you told me a specific position that you would like, there are several people who have said, "Oh, I'll help you anywhere you need help." I did not put your name down, and that was intentional because I had rather you tell me where you would like to help. Now, please don't misunderstand. If you're not able to help, we're not going to pass judgment on you. God knows that. And if you just really don't want to help, I had rather you not be here because that's just going to hinder the Holy Spirit if you come with a negative attitude. But if you want to help, I would love for you to help. And I mean, I don't know how to say it any other way. So I did put down my family's name on here, and Nancy's sister always comes and helps. I have her name down on here, but all of my family have said, I asked my nephew, I said, "Josh, do you still want to do recreation?" Because he and two of his friends, they like to do the recreation. And he said, "Yeah, I would love to do recreation." He said, "But if you need me anywhere else, we're happy to help wherever we can." So if you'd rather have those positions, fill them in, and we'll move him somewhere else. But he just wants to be here to help, and his buddies want to be here to help. And they're not showing fellas. So I have their names down. I have my niece down because she's a senior in high school this year. She's graduating this week. She's a craft person. She's artsy crafts. And so I've got her name down, but she can't do it on her own. And she said, "If you need me somewhere else, I'll do it somewhere else." So again, there's positions that have been filled in, and I'm pretty sure that we're all willing to work together, and if the need arises that we need to put you somewhere else, I have full confidence that everybody in this room will do whatever they're willing to do, or do whatever needs to be done. I put down the music position. I usually do that, but if you would like to do it, you're more than welcome to. I'll step aside. If you don't do it, I'll fill that position. So as you get your promotional this week, we're also going to give you a piece of paper and the pass this on there. If you have a place that you would like to work, please put your name down on this paper and give it back to me. Again, if you've already told me a specific position, I already have you down. So with that said, I'm going to turn it over to these kiddos here and let them start giving you some gifts. So thank you for your prayers. And before I turn it over, I'm going to ask the preacher if he'll just say an opening prayer for Bible school this year.
Our Father, we're so grateful for the honor of being able to serve these children who are the future leaders of this church and as well as our community and nation. And Father, we pray for a mighty working of the power of God to fall fresh upon this church, that we will experience revival in and through Vacation Bible School. We pray for those that will be teaching. We pray for those, Lord, who will be doing all that they can to promote your love and to teach more and more about Jesus. We pray for the children in the community that we might be able to reach some, O Father, so that they'll come and they'll learn about Jesus, that they'll bring their families to worship. Lord, we just ask that you would bless this nation Guide us and direct us, Lord, in this age of secularism. I pray that we'll be able to turn the tide and that we'll begin to see, O God, that truly you are the God that we serve. As the scripture tells us, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. And we pray this in Jesus' name.
Thank you. It's just a reminder that we all face pressure
We all face stress in life that are beyond our control. To find that you have a child who chooses to get involved with people who lead them into bad choices. The doctor diagnosing you with cancer or some other terminal disease. Back last April, when the tornado began to make its way and ravage through our fair town of Sunday. Terrorist plots to bring great devastation to our communities and to our nation. Someone pulling out in front of you and causing an accident and wreaking havoc on your physical and your emotional health. All of these things happen. They happen in the life that we live. We don't know what will happen for the next moment. You know, every morning when I get up, my phone alerts me to the news for the day, local news. And almost every morning as I get up, I can see where someone has been shot and killed or someone has been in a wreck. They're on 85 or 385 or some of the other stretches throughout Greenville County. And what can happen when these things happen to us? It causes us to panic. You know, there's a thing called panic disorder. Now, that's a chemical imbalance where you have this sense of dread. It's a panic that comes over you. And it's not rational, but it comes. You're not able to breathe. And you pour sweat begins to pour out on you. And you feel like you're getting ready to die. That's a panic disorder. It's a terrible thing. But then there's that panic that comes when something comes that is beyond our control. And I have no doubt that when those Israelites looked back and saw Pharaoh and his army coming after them, there was the sense of panic and the sense of dread. And we see there in verses 10 through 12, and when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid, and the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. First of all, they were surprised. Life has a lot of surprises, doesn't it? Some are very unwanted surprises. Most of the surprises we get are not the ones that we really want. Such as you're in the very hot of the season, your air conditioning goes out. Surprise! Or maybe your hot water goes out. Or maybe you got a leaky roof. Maybe your car quits running just after you made the last payment. These kind of things happen. Surprises happen all the time. And my dad used to always say, and I understand exactly what he means now. You know, you look back and you see, remember your parents saying things and doing things? Things that maybe you made fun of and thought they were so dumb. My dad used to say, well, that's life. That's life. There's some real wisdom in that, isn't there? That is life. These things happen. So we all have surprises, but for sure, the Israelites were shocked and surprised at what was coming toward them. We see that they were terrified. They looked up and they saw the Egyptians marching after them, and it says that they were sore afraid. Have you ever been sore afraid before? Well, I see it happen. I've had it in my own life. I never forget, there was a really tough guy in our neighborhood. He was kind of a popular guy, but he was real tough. Although he was shorter than I was, I don't know how that worked. But he was a real tough guy. And I remember he wasn't very smart either. Now back then we thought he was real smart, but I realized how unsmart he was. One night we went out and he took a Coke bottle and put some gas in it and stuffed a rag in it, and that was going to be our lantern. That doesn't seem so smart. But I walked around with him, but it was from a distance. But he decided he was, something happened. He got out of control and he dropped the bottle and his pants lay caught on fire. And I remember he started running. That's the worst thing you can do, kids. You know what to do. Stop, drop, roll, okay? Well, he was running. And that fire was getting bigger and bigger on that pants leg. And so it was just me and another guy. And the other guy was just paralyzed. He was sore afraid. And I looked at him, and I looked at my friend running with his pants on fire. And I decided I'd go after him. I ran and I knocked him down and began to beat out the fire. You know, when you panic, then, and you get sore afraid of where you're paralyzed, then you get in trouble. And we see that that very well could have happened to the Israelites. And we also see that they were victimized there in verse 11. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Israel, in Egypt. Now, by the way, this is kind of tongue-in-cheek stuff. This is sarcasm. Because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Are there not enough cemeteries in Egypt that you thought you had to bring us out here in the wilderness? Boy, they were really complaining, weren't they? That was a foreshadowing of all the complaining that they would do against Moses. And they said, wherefore hast thou dealt with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Well, and then they go on to say, is this not the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? You know, rather than asking why sometimes, we need to ask why not. And I never forget when Andy was born, my great-grandmother, she called me, and she just wondered, why did this happen to you? And my response was, why not me? And you know, we have to take these things that happen to us, and we need to try to allow God to show us through it. Most of you know Jeff Hart. Did you see that on Channel 4 this week? We've been wondering, Lord, now, what happened to Jeff Hart? We love him. He started out as a sports caster and did a wonderful job. He'd come to Seneca some and cover the Bobcats and other teams in the county. And he was always there at the Special Olympics in Greenville at Furman University. I would see him there. He would kind of host it. Just thought the world of him. Had those beautiful kids, four kids. And then in December, he just took a leave of absence. And we wondered, what happened to him? And you know, when you don't know something, you tend to make things up. And so that maybe there was rumors around or whatever. But then I was outside and I got a text on my phone, and it said that there is a report on why Jeff Hart is no longer at the station. And I ran inside and said, Glory, turn the news on. I want to hear this. And so when I began to listen to Jeff, and I saw his tears, Glory and I, we cried with him and with his family, as he has early onset Alzheimer's, which is a horrible thing to happen to someone so bright and so youthful as Jeff. And yet, he was not acting like the victim at all. He was giving the glory of God, and he wanted to work through this as best he could, and he wanted to present a great example to the community. And he's well on his way. So we need to look out for victimization. And we see that all over this nation today. We're being told that we're all victims of our society. We're victims of our heritage, or we're victims of our being raised by parents that made mistakes. And I'm sick and tired of it. Amen. We're not victims. God has blessed us with freedom. We have the freedom to choose how we live our lives, each and every one of us. And when you become a victim, then you're no longer useful. All you're doing is complaining. And then we see that there was compromise. They were settling for less. They were giving in. They were giving up to Pharaoh. And it said there in verse 12, for it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. They were compromising. But I'm here to tell you, when you're going through a difficult time in life, don't give in, don't give up, and certainly don't play the victim. Don't compromise. Don't settle for less. God has great plans for you. He has great plans for our lives if we would just but trust Him. But then we see in verse 13, and Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, see the salvation of the Lord, which He will show to you today. For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. Wow. Moses may not be offering these words as comfort to them, but I look at it another way. He's being very stern with them. Like, what is wrong with you? You have seen the power of God, and now you're playing the victim, and you're compromising, and you're saying, well, it's better for us to go back into slavery. than to die out here in the wilderness. He was getting on to them because of their lack of faith. How many times have I wanted to kick myself for having a lack of faith in the power of God to do what only God can do? For Paul wrote, he said, "For he can do immeasurably more than all that we ask or imagine." That's our God that we serve. You remember the calming of the storm? The disciples were there on the Sea of Galilee. The storm came up and began to blow, and the wind and the waves were just wreaking havoc on the ship, and Jesus was asleep. And they woke him up and said, "You know, what's wrong with you, Jesus? We're about to die." And Jesus, he stood up and he said, "Peace be still." And there's a calm that came over the ocean of the sea. And then he said, "Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith?" After seeing all the miracles he had already performed. And it says the disciples, they feared exceedingly. You know, we can so relate to the disciples. We're weak, just like they are. Sometimes we lack courage. And certainly, sometimes, many times, we lack our faith in God. And so we see here in verse 13, "Fear ye not." Don't be afraid. Don't panic when things do not go your way. Don't panic. And second of all, it says here, "Stand still." Or another way to say that is stand firm. Don't forget who you are. Don't forget whose you are. Don't forget your mission. Don't forget your purpose. Don't let anything deter you. Stay focused. Focus your eyes on Jesus. He is the author and the perfecter of your faith. He's with you. He's not going to forsake you. Don't panic. Stand firm. Paul wrote to the Galatians. He said, "It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourself be burdened again by a yoke of slavery." And then he wrote to the Ephesians chapter 6. He said, "Therefore put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, and it will come, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. Stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, the breastplate of righteousness, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes with the gospel of peace." Just as Tammy was telling these children, what we're wanting to teach them is to stand firm in the midst of a society that's growing more and more hostile toward Christianity. And what is it we stand for? We stand for the love of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Love. Amen. That's what we stand for. And they're saying, they don't like it. Because that love sets us free. God's love sets us free to be who He wants us to be. And to serve Him. Paul wrote to Philippians. He says, "Stand firm in one spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you." So we are to stand firm in what we believe. And then we're to watch. We see there in chapter 14, verse 13, he says, "For the Egyptians," he said, "see the salvation of the Lord." The salvation. "See the rescue of the Lord, which he will show to you today," not tomorrow, today. "For the Egyptians whom you have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. You will see the deliverance that the Lord will bring to you." We have to watch. Look for what God and only God can do for you. You remember Oral Roberts? You remember back in the 70s, I remember on Sunday morning, as they would have their show, it was all about positive thinking. But they had this song that was really catchy, and actually I liked it. It says, "Something good is going to happen to you today." And that's exactly what Moses was telling them. Something good is going to happen. Just watch. Just watch and see what God can do. Jesus spoke of His coming. He said, "Be always on your watch, and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, and you may be able to stand before the Son of Man." He said, lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing nigh. And then we're to surrender to the Lord. It says in verse 14, the Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. Surrender to God. You remember David when he was faced with Goliath and the Philistines? What did he say? He said, the battle is the Lord's. He surrendered to God so that he might be able to defeat those Philistines. I'm sure you've heard this story. And there's a commercial out that has it, but it's such a beautiful story. It was in a concert. It was about to begin. The mother returned to her seat and found that her son was gone. And all of a sudden, the curtains opened and the spotlight was on that beautiful piano there, the Steinway. And look, her son was up there on stage. And she panicked. She couldn't believe he was up there. And he began to play Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. And then the break had a rescue. He came behind the little boy and he told him, he says, don't quit, keep playing. And he began to play the bass part. And then he reached over on the other side of the boy and began to do a running obligato to make Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star a masterpiece. Now, perhaps that's the way it is with God. What we can accomplish on our own is hardly noteworthy. But we can do our best. But you know, the results aren't always like this graceful, flowing music. But with the hand of the Master, the Lord our God, our life's work can be truly if we trust in Him, if we submit to Him, no matter your talents, no matter your education, no matter your wealth, you just surrender to God, and He'll bless it, and your life will be beautiful. And then we see in verse 15, and the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go what, backward? No, that they go forward to move on. The Lord said, don't stand there in panic. Move forward. The Lord had a plan, and you know what it was. Parting the Red Sea. To allow the people to escape. Well, one of my best stories about moving on, probably heard it. But when my father died back in 2003, there's a crowd of people there in Simpsonville to speak to the family. It was time for visitation. And Gloria and I were standing near the front of the line, and then my other brother and his family, and then my father's casket, and Andy insisted on standing next to the casket where my dad was. And then his Uncle James, my dad's brother, was next to him, and then another set of family members. And so as the people made line, I noticed that as they would get past us, they would move on. They just move fast. And I thought, well, we got through a lot of people pretty quickly that night. It was amazing. And afterwards, the funeral director came up to me and said, we want to hire your son, Andy. I said, for what? He said, well, when they got to Andy, they would say, here's Papa Bill, Uncle James, now move on. Don't you wish you had an Andy at some of these receiving the friends? Move on. Do not stand still. Do not give up, but keep on keeping on. And that is indeed what is referred to as keeping the faith, fighting the good fight. And then, praise the Lord. In verse 4, chapter 14, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart that he shall follow after them, and I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his hosts, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. God gets the honor. Praise God. And it happens when He has His way in our lives. No matter what happens, we must not panic, but we must seek Him in His face and yield to His control and move as He directs. Thank you, Lord, for your word. And I pray, oh God, that it will just speak to the hearts of the people here today. Those who are listening, out in the parking lot, and those on Facebook, Lord, that their hearts have been touched. And Lord, that you encourage them and motivate them through your word. And I pray, oh God, that each of us will rededicate our lives to serve you fully and to experience the joy that comes out of surrendering and submitting our lives. Lord, we pray that you'll have your way in this invitation. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, perhaps you've never made a profession of faith in Christ, and this is the day the Holy Spirit's been working with you, and you feel this is the time, and as your pastor, I stand here, right here at the altar, to receive you and to encourage you and to pray with you and to present you as a candidate for baptism to be brought into the life of this church. Maybe you sense that this is where God is leading you to serve, Reedy Park Baptist Church. This is a wonderful congregation. It's a congregation that's made of so much love for one another and love for God. I invite you to come and be a part of our fellowship through the transfer of your membership from another church. Perhaps this morning you need to rededicate your life. And you've been panicking, you've been afraid about different things, and it's time to move on. I invite you to rededicate your life to the Lord Jesus Christ this morning. Won't you come as we stand together and sing our invitation hymn, The Old Rugged Cross, hymn number 327. Stand as we sing, hear it.